Pada tajuk 3 berkenaan dengan occupational health. Okay. So this is the overview of occupational health. Okay. So today our learning objective to understand the definition of occupational health, kesihatan pekerjaan. To explain the focus of occupational health, state the various discipline of occupational health. Okay. Then to explain the concept of prevention. This is very important. Concept of prevention in occupational health and application of epidemiology. What is epidemiology in occupational health? Alright. Okay. So ni definisi ya, definisi kesihatan pekerjaan kan, ataupun kita panggil definition of occupational health. So there are many definition under the occupational health. Biasa kita dengar occupational safety and health, right? So in occupational safety and health ni, we must understand consists of the safety and must consists of the occupational health, which is we cannot separate each others. Both actually correlated, berkait, safety berkait dengan occupational health, because whatever it is, impact dia adalah kepada pekerja, right? And of course, impact juga ada kepada industri, properties and what not. Okay, so yang kita risau adalah impact dia kepada kesihatan pekerja juga kan, dan juga kita nak mengelakkan kematian, death. Okay, so that's why the importance of at least not to understand very deep about occupational health, but at least safety officers have the pictures, overall pictures about occupational health. What to do to prevent the impact of the occupational health. Okay. So the definition, promotion and maintenance of the physical, mental and social level of staff in all work sectors. Okay. Prevention from illness, mencegah from illness and diseases to the workplace or process, right? Protection from risk at work, physical, chemical, biological and psychosocial. So after this kita akan tengok what is they mean by the protection itself, and also placement of workers in environment and job tasks suitable to their physiological and psychological capabilities. So this is placement of workers. That's why kita ada fitness for work. Kita buat medical check up, sebelum masuk confined space, untuk renew APC, license and what not, kita buat medical check up, because this is the placement of focus. Kita nak tengok fitness. Alright. So the focus of occupational health, to do the promotion and maintenance of worker optimum, in term of physical, mental and social levels. Before this, before this, kita cater for the physical fitness, physical health for the workers only. Dalam akta kita, dalam akta OSHA 94 yang kita belum ubah, kita tak ada, we are not talking about mental and social level. That's why the initiative and the start to include the mental health in the either our OSHA, to revise the our akta, and then this is the promotion activities, and maintenance, and then the focus of occupational health, we must do prevention. This is important. Kita tak boleh buat maintenance saja, kita must do prevention activities, intervention from illness or disease arising from the workplace or work progress. So that's why after this we learn about health surveillance, we will learn about medical surveillance, we will learn about, we are talking about the audiometry test and what not, medical checkup. This is all the prevention activity. And of course to increase quality of work environment and work process suitable to worker safety and health condition. So because this many studies from genome, from the researcher, shows that when the workers is fit, they have the quality of workers, they will increase the productivities and reduce the medical claim and whatnot in the industry. So Tadi dia ada fokus of occupational health. Okay. So, both concept, they must do promotion at the same time with the prevention activities. We must focus together. We cannot do only prevention. We cannot do only promotion. To have the good occupational health services in the industry for the workers, the aim is to make sure that the workers is at the optimum health, and also to prevent this occupational health disease, work-related illness and whatnot. Okay, so before we go further, there are two terms that are very important for us to understand, which is occupational disease and work-related diseases. These are sometimes we confused with the definition, occupational disease and work-related diseases. Okay, because they are in the group HSE, sampai di dalam group HSE ada orang tanya, kalau heart disease macam mana mereka boleh sebagai occupational disease ataupun tak, dan boleh reporting ataupun tak heart disease dengan heart attack. Okay, the scenario is like this. Kita ada dalam akta, kita ada dalam report, right? Dalam report 204 untuk classification of occupational disease. Dia tak ada mention work related diseases. Alright. Okay. Ini tak ada occupational disease dan work related disease. What is occupational disease? Occupational disease when the diseases, the cause of the disease is very clear. That related to occupational. There must be the agent or the source or the cause is the occupational related. Okay. And it is enough, only one cause can cause the diseases. Contohnya, benzene. And cause apa?
Cancer.
Leukemia, right? Okay. Cause leukemia. Satu benzene. Tak kira lah dia smoking ke, tak smoking ke. Dia smoking atau tak smoking, irrespective of this, benzene we know that can cause leukemia. They don't need any other factors.
Direct effect of the.
Yes, direct effect. And well known from the study. Okay. As example lagi, asbestos. Asbestos can cause lung cancer ataupun kita panggil mesothelioma. Okay, direct cause. Either dia smoking or not smoking, dia ada family history of cancer or not. Okay, irrespective of that, one factor is already good enough to cause the cancer. Okay, they don't need other factors as well. That is the occupational disease, direct. Whereas the work-related diseases, example, depression, right? Contohnya lah work-related depression. There are many other factors.
Depression is work-related.
Depression. Yeah, work-related. There are many other factors that can cause the depression. Your family history, of secondary disorder, family history, cool. Maybe stress, financial problem, then what not, depression, ataupun chronic diseases. There are many factors that can contribute to have the depression. But when we say work-related disease, when, if any of these factors are related with their workplace or occupational exposure. Example, the stress is not, the stress is not arise from the workplace. It arise from the family problem, but the stress is from the job stress.
Stress.
It's due to their job stress. Okay? job demand. Okay, they have the, we can measure, actually job stress we can measure. There are specific questionnaires to study on how we can come out, how we can say that the stress is due to the job stress. Okay, so then we call this is the work-related disease. But the disease to occur, they need other factors as well. Job stress alone is not very strong to cause the depression. Okay, so that the work-related diseases. So when they have, contohnya, example, when they have the depression or stress, they have the ischemic heart disease, heart attack. How we want to relate with the work-related diseases, then we need to study at their workplace. And jadi tak, environment dia can create the job stress or not. Okay? So that's the occupational, when we talk about the occupational disease or work-related illness. And illness at workplace. Okay. Okay, so promotion. So of course, untuk healthy lifestyle, we do life balance, anti smoking. We can have the drug and alcohol policies, prevention activities, lot. We can do the all the control, prevention control. Okay, next. When we talk about, we want to talk about prevention, we must understand the natural history of diseases. How we classify the diseases? When talk about diseases, how we classify diseases? Basically, we talk about diseases, illness. Disease ni, penyakit, kita boleh bagi kepada dua kategori. Satu yang communicable diseases, penyakit. Then also, non-communicable penyakit yang tak berjangkit. Biasanya kita punya approach macam tu. Penyakit berjangkit dengan penyakit tak berjangkit. Non-communicable disease. Communicable disease contohnya apa? Yang sebab kita buat apa ni, vaksin. Semua tu adalah penyakit berjangkit lah. Kita dengar-dengar daddy, kita dengar tentang diphtheria, tentang measles, mumps, rubella sebagainya. Ini adalah penyakit berjangkit lah. Pertusis. Non-communicable diseases, heart disease. Heart disease, deep-by system lah, respiratory illness. Okay. So that is the non-communicable diseases. Okay. So before we go to the prevention, we must understand the natural history of diseases. Natural history of disease. Natural history of disease ni maksudnya any kind of disease will progress if we not do anything. Penyakit ni akan berlarutan, berjalan. Ia akan bagi complication dan sebagainya jika kita tak buat prevention. Prevention ni maksudnya kita do something lah, makan ubat ke, seek treatment, kan, to stop the progress of the disease, penyakit tersebut. Okay? So this is the natural history of diseases. Okay? Okay. Penyakit tu akan berlaku, Okay. Dia ada empat fasa sebenarnya, Fasa pertama, dia panggil susceptible phase. Fasa kedua dipanggil preclinical. Fasa ketiga adalah clinical stage. And fasa keempat adalah recovery ataupun complication. Okay. Let's say we talking about the non-communicable diseases, penyakit yang tak berjangkit. Contohnya heart disease. We take about heart disease contohnya. penyakit jantung lah. Okay. Okay. So waktu susceptible phase ni, susceptible ni maksudnya apakah faktor-faktor yang menyebabkan seseorang tu expose diri dia boleh menyebab kepada sakit jantung. Apakah faktor-faktor dia? Okay, susceptible maksudnya dia risk factors lah. Risk factors. Dia ada risk factors. Siapa yang risk factor habis ni? Smoking, sedentary lifestyle, apa lagi ya? Okay, they have the chronic diseases, and then the less physical activity. Diet, high fat diet, okay, high sugar diet, okay, these are all the risk factors. And then your family history, these are all the risk factors susceptible phase. Yang menyebabkan seseorang itu expose high chances, high likelihood to get the high heart diseases. Okay, so preclinical stage. Whereby clinical, okay. Pre-clinical stage whereby they don't have the heart disease. Bila orang ada penyakit jantung, kan? Apa simptom-simptom dia? Sakit dada lah kan. Sakit dada, naik tangga sikit, penat, kan? Nak tidur pun kena dua bantal, kan? So dia penat, kan? So ini heart disease, kan? Lepas tu cepat berpeluh-peluh kalau sakit dada, okay. Waktu tu dia dah ada tanda-tanda. Kita panggil simptom. Simptom kat sini.
Not
okay. When the appearance of symptom, that's the clinical stage. But when is the preclinical? Pre-clinical, there is no symptom. But the disease is progress. But the kita panggil apa? Dia punya pathological progress. Still ongoing disease, kita tak nampak dalam salur darah dia.
But kan? This stage when you go for medical check-up, you might be able to detect.
Yes.
Only on visual scene, you won't be able to detect.
Yes. They don't have the symptom at all. They don't have the symptom at all. But the disease is still ongoing. The disease process is still ongoing. What we call is the, in medical term, they call it pathogenesis. Which is for ischemic heart disease, dia punya atherosclerosis. Like dia punya vessels kan. They get thicken of the blood vessels, wall, okay, dia plak, dia punya kolesterol semua dia akan menempel kat sini kan. So the lumen, the size lumen tu lebih lama lebih kecil. That's why the heart disease. So this process ni without the symptom, dia ongoing. Semakin tebal dia punya lumen. Nanti sampai one stage, blood is not enough to the heart muscle, then they will have the heart disease. They call it ischemic heart disease. Okay, so they have the symptom. So usually, if we are not doing the screening, then you will catch up during you have the clinical stage. So that's why this the time that. And quite late when we detect this. That's why sometimes when we detect, they need to do the bypass already because of complete block or whatnot. It depends on the how percent block. And then they will go to the complication stage. The block can mulai to the brain and they can have the stroke. So that the complication. So many complication. They can have the heart failure, kaki bengkak, duduk lama-lama, and they can have stroke. Okay, it's all the complication. And some after we do some intervention, and they can recovery. Okay, bypass and whatnot. Okay, so this is the natural history of disease if we are not doing anything. So that's why, okay, this is all example of one disease. Okay, so that's why we have the, we call it primary prevention, secondary prevention, and tertiary prevention. Where from natural history of disease ni, we want to put the primary prevention is here. This is the primary prevention. Okay, secondary prevention. And tertiary prevention. We apply here. So what is primary prevention? We do regulations, we create policy, we do control measures, okay? We give immunization, we give universal precaution, we give PPE, so this all the primary prevention. Kita punya risk factors. Kalau let's say you ambil natural history of disease to injury, then you bagilah PPE and any risk control, admin control, you job rotation, you create work process, okay, work procedure, any policy, and that's all the in the primary prevention. So let's say you ambil contoh TB, so you give vaccines, you make sure they have vaccinated and our workers. Okay, so that is the primary prevention. Okay, kita tengok secondary prevention. Primary prevention dia fokus kepada specific protection. We give specific protection to the workers or the patient or the population. Secondary prevention, the term is early detection and prompt treatment, early treatment. The keywords is early detection and prompt treatment. Early detection is here, preclinical stage, early detection. So, if let's say ischemic heart disease, we must do the screening, medical screening, sebab tu kita ada umur 40-45, we advise to do the early screening and what not. Health monitoring. Okay. Then early treatment. If they have the diagnose or they have the screen, they must get the early treatment. Okay. So what the other activities? They can do the heart monitoring. Let's say if you talk about injury, we do for the first aid. So we must have the emergency response plan and what not. Okay. Then what is tertiary prevention? We want to have the limited disability and rehabilitation. That the keyword. Limited disability and rehabilitation. That's the three prevention. This is when we talk about SHO punya peranan. They do a lot of activities of rehabilitation. Then also to limit the disability. And kalau siapa yang tak pernah melawat SHO di Melaka, boleh melawat lah. Then you can at least you know what the SHO punya facility untuk workers. Okay, so dia ada punya hostel dan sebagainya kan untuk buat rehabilitation very big dekat Melaka Okay, so dia ada disability assessment, they have the physiotherapy, conversation. After full rehabilitation apa semua, then they decide sama ada they give pension, they give compensation, and also if they can work, they can back to work program lah, kita tak dapat pension. Dapat pension hilang dan sebagainya. So that the tertiary prevention. Elimination of all the complication. Back to work, return to work program and what not. So that in the tertiary prevention. Okay, boleh understand eh? So this is the prevention. Okay? Alright. Okay. Occupational health discipline. Tadi kita dah tengok what is panel eh. Tak ada promotion. Tak ada prevention. So what is the discipline of occupational health? Is it only occupational health doctors is doing all the services, kan? And of course in industry, in our structure, orang yang competent. Now, if I'm not mistaken, we have the occupational health doctors, and we have the hygiene, kan? We have the hygiene tech lah. We have the hygiene tech 1, hygiene tech 2, ergonomist.
Cik, yang terakhir tu. Thank you.
penyakit pun sama. You can take example of penyakit-penyakit juga. So sama, naturally dia punya susceptible pun sama, risk factors untuk penyakit-penyakit. Okay, preclinical dia pun sama juga. Dia tak terus bila kita contohnya TB, kan? Okay, you tak terus hari ini you expose, katakanlah you pergi pasar malam, very crowded area, lepas tu ada orang ludah dan sebagainya, then you biasanya you akan inhale that bacillus. Okay, dia tak terus malam tu you dapat, dia ada dipanggil incubation period, ada masa dia akan jaga apa semua, baru you akan dapat symptom dia. Okay, lepas tu bila dia dapat symptom, dia demam malam, peluh-peluh, dia ada batuk dan sebagainya, you pergi hospital, baru dia diagnosis dapat TB. Tapi kalau you buat screening, you buat screening, mental test dan sebagainya pun you boleh detect, you ada TB, active TB ataupun tak. Then they talk about the complication lah, tentang penyakit. So natural history of disease ni applicable, this is applicable for non-communicable disease and communicable disease as well. Okay, and prevention dia pun sama. Prevention dia pun sama. Yang saya bagi contoh ni, kalau we talk about communicable disease, usually ada vaksin lah kat sini. Kalau cat penyakit tu memang dah ada vaksin. So this one dia ada primary prevention, we can do, we can vaccinate them. Contohnya macam typhoid, pekerja-pekerja yang reacted kepada makanan, dia mesti dapat injection untuk typhoid, kan? So that is the primary prevention activities. Kalau tak, orang boleh dapat food poisoning, because of the typhoid. Okay. Ergonomics, sekarang is still not competent yet, kan? Belum, kan? Ergonomics is not the orang yang competent lagi lah dalam kita punya DOSH. So hygiene type 1, hygiene type 2, occupational health doctor, because you have the usual regulation. So we have the ergonomic, this is not about discipline lah, ergonomics. We have the epidemiology. Epidemiology more on the public health, kesihatan awam kita panggil, epidemiology. Epidemiology ni actually to study the distribution of the diseases. Basically kita nak tahu, kan, berapa banyak accident, berapa banyak yang pekerja yang ada non-communicable disease, yang ada penyakit tak berjangkit ni, kan. Banyak yang kolesterol tinggi, heart disease, berapa pekerja yang stress. Ini semua all the epidemiologies lah, yang main dengan statistik, data. Last time injuries, kan. So they play with the data. Berapa yang ada musculoskeletal diseases. Kalau kita tengok DOSH punya statistik, so punya statistik, kan. Berapa yang ada penyakit apa ni, sakit musculoskeletal, kan, ataupun penyakit muscle dan otot lah. Okay, this is the epidemiology, study the history of disease and the causation of disease. Apa penyakit-penyakit mungkin baru, kan, yang tahu penyebab dan penyakit. That's the epidemiologist punya specialty, kan. And occupational medicine, occupational medicine, of course, to talk about the occupational diseases lah, in terms of the treatment. Okay, occupational toxicology, berkenaan dengan chemicals lah, mainly related to chemical. They study about the permissible exposure limit, kita punya cut off point. Okay, so that the occupational toxicology. Okay, and what about the mental health, we call it industrial psychology. Somehow, some others talk about the industrial psychology also in the ergonomy. Okay, so depends, kita panggil IO, industrial organization. Some mention about industrial psychology. So that's the, we are not left the mental health issues. Okay, so we especially we understand what is industrial hygiene. By definition, I mentioned the science and art devoted to the anticipation, anticipate, and then recognize, evaluate, and then they control of those environmental factors or stresses arising from the workplace which may cause sickness, infant health and well-being, or significant discomfort and emergency among workers, citizens, and also the community. Okay, let's talk about the ergonomics. Ini by bahasa lah, definition ergonomic. Literally means the loss of work. Epidemiology, as I explained, distribution and causes of disease. Epidemiology. How and why distribution of disease are concentrated to certain group or areas. So, how we apply the epidemiology to understand the causes of various disease, as I explained, assess the level of harm and disease causing agent material, and benzene can cause cancer. That's the example. And then for epidemiology juga, we determine the permissible exposure limits. How we derive from the permissible exposure limit from the study. And we can specific plan the occupational safety and health program according to the statistic. So that we know how where we want to focus. So this is the orang yang competent lah. Safety health officer, CHRA related to occupational health services. We have the hygiene type 1, 2, OHD, OHN. It's not the OIK. Okay? Dia bukan OIK. Orang yang competent. Only OHD. And only nurse ni, we are trained on the occupational health. But they are not the OIK. Dia tak daftar. Occupational health services. Until identify control hazard, provision of early treatment, okay? Educate both management and workers on the joint responsibility of ensuring and safeguarding safety and health at work. And promote healthy lifestyle program. They do health promotion, they do health education. Exposure monitoring, important. Health risk assessment, HRE. For the consultant in the industry, we do health risk assessment and hazard control. And so many things yang sebenarnya kita boleh buat in the occupational services. Occupational fitness assessment, medical surveillance, suiting the work and work environment to the worker, general medication treatment, first aid, medical aid, disability assessment, data collection. Many things that we do in industry. However, it depends on the commitment and how we convince the company. Usually, as now in Malaysia, we more related on the law. Kalau tak ada requirement, have to check up daripada DOSH, then difficult to promote the occupational services. So biasanya kita akan masuk dengan start with the medical surveillance, first aid training, so that how we go to the industry and provide the occupational services. Slowly, we can do the occupational services. Slowly, we will grow the occupational services and give benefit to the workers actually. Okay, but we must have the passion. Alright, so of course, organization related, we have a DOSH in terms of the legislations. And as I mentioned, we very difficult just to do the health education, health promotion, and the workplace. Without the legislation, so we need the OSHA, we need the standard, we need the regulation that promote the occupational health services. And then in terms of training center, we have the NIOSH that produce the occupational health doctors. They are doing research as well. So very very important to occupational health services in Malaysia and other country as well in term of the compensation, rehabilitation, rehabilitation services and also promotion of the occupational health services, very strong. And Ministry of Health, because the dia panggil apa, jemaah doctors, who are come to the conclusion whereby your disability punya decision. This is the doctor from the Ministry of Health. They will appoint only doctors in MOH, Ministry of Health. Okay. So other universities, they are teaching and doing teaching and learning, producing SHO, producing managers, occupational service as well. Okay. So in other country, we have HSE in UK, have NIOSH, ACGIH, that we have the threshold limit values that we refer. Ataupun biological monitoring kita, mainly we follow the ACGIH, US. And then we have the some guideline, we follow international level organization. And we have the International Agency for Research into Cancers, because we are worried about many chemicals that can cause cancers nowadays. So this IARC agency is they study about the sources that can cause cancer and the link with the cancer. Okay, so any question before we end the first topic? Any questions? Yeah. Okay. We take less 5 minutes. Okay. Then we continue the next topic.